Greetings, friends of typography. Computer keyboards have been around for decades, and when you want a new one, you have thousands of models to choose from. But interestingly, we rarely question the layout printed on these keyboards. For example, on your keyboard, you might see this character, which you might use as an apostrophe, but it's not actually a proper apostrophe. That looks like this. The correct version isn't even part of standard keyboard layouts. You might also use this symbol for quotations, but you are missing all these proper quotation marks. You'll find a hyphen, but probably not an n-dash or m-dash printed on any key. And how could this be? We're not talking about obscure characters. These are common punctuation marks that can appear in almost every text typed on a computer. And yet, standard keyboard layouts don't give us easy access to the proper versions of these characters. In this video, we are going to explore why computer keyboards are so limited in this regard, and I'll introduce a way to finally overcome these limitations. To understand why today's keyboards are limited in their character sets, we have to go all the way back to the 19th century. Various kinds of writing machines were being proposed at the time, like this one using the mechanism of piano keys. But commercial success came with models that stacked several rows of keys on top of each other, creating a compact layout that could be used with both hands. To achieve this, there is an offset between the key rows. The reason for this staggering was to allow equal distance between the arms that connect the keys to the typewriting mechanism. And that's a feature we kept until today. It took only about 10 years from the first patent to arrive at the familiar keyboard design, complete with the shift key and the QWERTY layout. The typewriter, as it was called, created a new niche between handwriting and mass text production via letterpress printing. Like handwriting, typewriters produced individual documents, but with prefabricated letterforms, much like typesetting in a print shop. Interestingly, the creators of typewriters didn't simply adopt the character sets already established in the printing industry. Instead, they minimized the character sets as much as possible, likely for several reasons, cost reduction being an obvious one. But convenience for a broad user base was likely another. Touch typing imposes limits on how many keys can be reached quickly and accurately with 10 fingers. Compare that to the professional keyboards used in print shops, like the linotype or monotype keyboards. Those keyboards maintained the established professional character sets, but were used only by trained operators. The makers of typewriters took a different approach. While letters and figures didn't offer many opportunities to reduce the character set, they did make some compromises, like using the same symbol for the figure 1 and the lowercase letter L. The most drastic reductions regarding the character set happened in the area of punctuation marks. These two characters had to stand in for at least the apostrophe and all quotation marks. And the hyphen was also used as a way to create a longer n-dash or m-dash. This created what we can now call typewriter typography. For decades, this limited character set was acceptable, because text produced with typewriters was being used as personal or business letters and manuscripts. When a writer completed a novel or newspaper article, typesetters would turn the manuscript into professional typesetting, replacing typewriter characters with proper punctuation marks according to established typographic rules. In the mid-20th century, typewriter keyboards transitioned into computer input devices. This could have been a chance to rethink the keyboard layout, but unsurprisingly, not much changed. With millions of people already familiar with typewriters, keeping the established alphanumeric layout made sense, with only a few additional system keys added. At this point, there was no need to expand the character set. In fact, early computer character sets were reduced to 7 bits, meaning even lowercase letters were excluded, like in the early days of the typewriter. Later, 8-bit character sets became common, effectively doubling the size of the character set, but leading to a rather messy situation where companies like Microsoft, Apple, and IBM each created their own incompatible character sets for different regions. Interestingly, these characters could be accessed from keyboards, but without showing the symbols on the keys. For instance, on Windows, holding the Alt key and typing a 3-digit or 4-digit code on the numpad allows access to the extended character set. But this method is inconvenient and rarely used. Plus, it's designed for full-size keyboards, making it difficult or impossible to be used on laptops and other mobile devices. Apple, on the other hand, added 2 additional keyboard layers, accessed using the Option key or Option plus Shift. It's more convenient than Microsoft's solution, but shares similar flaws. It's not intuitive. Users must know that these hidden keyboard shortcuts exist and they must learn them one by one. The layout printed on most computer keyboards is, in essence, still the typewriter layout. This is more than just an inconvenience for computer users. It leads to poor typography. In fact, typewriter typography is so widespread today that we are nearing a tipping point where it may become the new standard. This would be unfortunate because using a broader set of spaces and punctuation marks helps readers to better understand the text by clearly grouping and separating elements. By the way, using so-called smart quotes, where software replaces typewriter-style input with proper punctuation, isn't a sufficient solution either. The software often struggles to determine the correct replacement, and users must input text in specific ways for the software to correctly distinguish between, say, a hyphen and an n-dash. As a result, this feature often causes more harm than good. So why hasn't anyone addressed these issues? Why do we accept the status quo? And why do keyboard manufacturers offer thousands of models but not a single one that includes more punctuation marks or other typography symbols printed on the keys? The answer lies in technological lock-in. Keyboard makers can print whatever they want on the keys, but they don't control the actual text output. The keyboard just sends a key code to the operating system, which then determines the output based on the installed software layout. So, keyboard manufacturers stick to standard layouts, printing only the characters on the keys that those software layouts support. Meanwhile, software providers stick to the established layouts to ensure that their layouts are compatible with millions of existing physical keyboards. Additionally, millions of users expect a certain layout, and national and international standards reinforce the established designs. So, how can we break this cycle? The answer is clear. We need to address all these areas simultaneously. Creating a custom layout and sharing it with colleagues won't solve the problem. Instead, we need better standards, and those standards should extend existing layouts rather than conflict with them. Many alternative layouts have been proposed, often with the goal of improving the typing speed or ergonomics, but whatever advantages they offer, they are outweighed by the incompatibility with millions of existing devices. But simply adding characters to existing layouts doesn't cause much disruption. Typewriters were limited to 2 characters per key, but computer keyboards can easily accommodate more. We can add additional layers and print those characters on the keys to make them more accessible. We don't have to accept the status quo. Case in point, this has just happened in Germany. a new version of the German keyboard standard came into effect last year, and it maintains the typical keyboard layout, while also offering a compatible extended version, where the already existing third layer is filled up and two new layers are being added, offering the output of up to 5 characters per key, not even including dead key combinations. And this extended keyboard layout that is not bound to a specific operating system contains the entire toolset of professional typography. Apostrophe, quotation marks, ellipses, n-dash, m-dash, minus sign, multiplication sign, almost all Latin diacritical marks, even special characters like soft hyphen, non-breaking space, and the non-joiner marker. It's everything that a writer or graphic designer would ever need for professional typesetting. If you are in Germany or Austria, you can start using this layout today. If you are in another country, let's work together to create similar layouts for other regions. Share this video or the current German keyboard standard with colleagues. And let's gather experts to create better keyboard standards. Professional organizations representing graphic designers or writers could easily sponsor and facilitate this process. Creating new standards isn't as hard as it may look. All it takes is people taking the initiative. But creating better keyboard layout standards is only step one. The existence of the standard alone doesn't achieve anything in and of itself. We also need people and organizations to promote the idea and offer education and training around it. And I certainly plan on doing that myself, because I truly believe that these extended standardized keyboard layouts are a good idea. They are beneficial to the people writing and typesetting texts, and they can help us to maintain a higher typographic standard, which in turn can help all readers. And finally, we need physical keyboards which have the extended layout printed on them. When those extended layouts are compatible to existing layouts, they can be used instantly just as a software layout. But that's not enough. That's just a slightly better version of what we already have with the Windows and Mac-specific solutions I explained earlier. An extended layout that is actually printed on the keys would be a game changer. And I speak from experience. For the new extended German layout, I created a software layout for macOS, since that didn't exist. I instantly installed it when I was done, and I quickly learned like a dozen of the most important additional keyboard shortcuts. But that was it. Of course, I didn't memorize the hundreds of shortcuts this layout provides. I would need to see them on the keyboard to access them easily and maybe learn more of them over time. So I actually went ahead and created the first hardware solution for this keyboard layout, in the form of keycaps for mechanical keyboards that support both Windows and macOS. And I used my type design experience for this. The legends are printed in multiple colors to clearly separate the different layers, and so I created a color font where each glyph represents an entire key. And then I used that font in Adobe Illustrator for the layout of the entire keyboard. And the difference between the Windows and the macOS version is implemented as an OpenType feature, so I can easily switch between the two layouts. If you are in Germany or Austria, you can check out my Kickstarter campaign for these keycaps. And if you are elsewhere, let me know what you think about these extended layouts. I'm happy to support similar initiatives in other countries. And yes, I admit, these layouts can be a little overwhelming, reintroducing a problem the typewriter already solved. So I'm not suggesting that these extended layouts become the standard for everyone. But I believe they could become a standard for professionals, like writers and graphic designers. What do you think? Let me know in the comments.